Spring Jubilee. It's time to worship. Let's stand together. Extremely warm welcome to each of you. Great to have you with us. This is the day the Lord's made. And Father, we thank you today. We're going to worship with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind. We thank you, Lord, that we love to offer our bodies as a living sacrifice. We love to come before you, into your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise. We anticipate tonight, Lord, signs, wonders, miracles, healings, encounters, and visitations. We thank you for all that you are to us, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen.
I will become more dignified. I will. Thank you. the shelter of your song. You cradle all my soul. Keep me like a ring upon your finger.
Thank you.
naked and out of shame, Lord, 'cause it feels like you see everything, but you covered me after the tree.
Jesus, oh, love made a way. Oh, love made a way. Oh, love made a way. Makes a way for us. Oh, love made a way. Makes a way in the wilderness, oh God. When the desert places, oh, love made a way, makes a way, makes a way. Oh, love makes a way. It's nothing like your love. Thank you.
just saw the love of God making a way in the wilderness and streams in the desert places, that where there's a need, God's love fills that place. He creates life where there's no life. He creates hope where there's no hope. He brings healing where it's needed. And just see the love of God just being poured out tonight in a way that's beyond measure. And we just sometimes takes time to press in and find that place with God. And it's the most important place, the secret place. David said, I found a place near your altar, O Lord. So good. The goodness of God is in this place tonight, and it's His goodness that leads us to His throne of grace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's just thank Him for His goodness tonight. Thank you, Lord. 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 Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Just the plane won't land. Just find someone nearby and say good evening to them and find a seat. It's great to have you with us tonight. Welcome to Jubilee, to our evening service. Wonderful to be in God's presence.
Come on, let's give these guys a thank you. That was great, guys. Thank you. That was beautiful. What beautiful worship. Woohoo! Thank you, Lord. We just want to welcome you to Jubilee. Just a few quick announcements before we get going. Well, over here, some of these things are over here. Before we go this morning, we mentioned this, but I just wanted to let everyone know it's Finney and Izzy's 34th wedding anniversary today. They're amazing. An amazing couple. I know that you guys really transformed Meg's and our lives when you came into our life. That's what I was trying to say. Our lives were greatly transformed. I couldn't imagine how many lives have been transformed over the years, you know, especially marriages. I just want a successful, I was looking up love because I got all like excited for the love thing, and it says love is, this is just some good quotes, you know, outside of the Word of God, but a successful marriage requires falling in love many times, always with the same person. Another one said, to be fully seen by someone and then to be loved anyway, this is a human offering and can border on miraculous. I think that's a pretty good quote. Did you get that one? Yeah. Took me a while to read, understand what she was trying to say, but I get it. It's beautiful. And then I saw another one that said, love, all you need for marriage is like a pack of cards. In the beginning, you just need two hearts and a diamond. And then by the end, you want a club and a spade. No, that's not very nice. It's not true. That's not true. Most of the time. Thank you, Lord. Okay, a couple of quick announcements. Healing Rooms is back. Starts back Wednesday, 1st of February. Wednesday, the 1st of February, 12 till 2, and Saturday, 12 till 2. So thank you for being patient. We've had a good break. Our teams needed a good break. They pray faithfully for everybody, and it's back on. So for those of you who don't know what it is, we have Healing Rooms next door in the room here every Wednesday and every Saturday, 12 till 2. So just bring the sick, or you can just come to church and we can pray for you as well. We're going to take the offering because I didn't write it down here. I don't know, I'll forget it. So before we do, can I share you a scripture? I love this when they're rebuilding the temple in Ezra. And I never actually saw this scripture before, and I thought it was a really good scripture. It's in Ezra 3:7. It says, and they gave money to the masons and the carpenters. That's a good day. Come on. I'm a carpenter as well. So, no. But they started building the temple, right? And then the Bible says that when they laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests, and it says that when they laid it, there was such a great, I'm just sort of going down like paraphrasing here. All the people gave a great shout of praise to the Lord because the foundation of the Lord was laid. But many of the older priests and the Levites and family heads who had seen the former temple wept aloud when they saw the foundations of the temple being laid, while many others shouted for joy. And it goes on to say that they couldn't distinguish between the cries of great joy. I think they were crying though. They're crying because they laid it in the wrong spot, or they were crying because they saw the former one and they were so excited. They just had such a heart for it to be laid. And my guess is it's the second one. But there was so much passion from the older generation, and then the younger ones were shouting. And it says that even their enemies come and said, hey, can we come and help you build this thing? And they said no. But it was, I just thought it was amazing that even the enemies come to build. And I pray that you have such a heart to see God's house being built wherever you are, even if it's somebody's life being transformed, foundations reestablished in someone's life, that whether you saw a past move of God and you're starting to see what's happening through Jubilee, because we're having a new move of God and there's unbelievable what's happening, or whether you're part of the younger generation, you see the shouts of joy. I just pray that, and I believe actually that we're in this season, we're seeing emerging of older people, like the older generation that's seen past revivals, and the younger ones that are seeing this revival, and there's emerging, and no one can hear the difference of sound, whether it's wailing or shouting. And we're going to see people coming from everywhere going, what is it? Can we just help? I don't even know what you're doing. Can I just help? It's going to be amazing. I believe we're in that season. So it's very exciting. So I don't know. Did we just take up the offering? I think we did. Everyone missed it because they were listening, weren't they? Such good listeners. Okay, one more quick thing, and then I don't know if we've got any testimonies. I'm not sure. Izzy, you've got a testimony. Fantastic. Next Sunday, the 5th of February, our 10 a.m. service, we're having Jubilee's 20th anniversary. That is epic. Come on. I think we've got a little clip. Oh. So come along, we're going to have a barbecue straight after the service. We've got 20 sausages that we're going to give out to the first 20. No, we haven't. We're having a barbecue, so please come along straight after the service and help celebrate everything that these guys have done. Just welcome Izzy as she comes to share what's going on.
Ryan, you're on form tonight. That's funny. How many of you enjoy the way he gives announcements? Put the rest of us to shame. Okay, so we've come out of an amazing time of rest. How many of you had a good rest? How many of you would like a good rest still? We can organize that. All right, so I went for a week just to visit my mum, who immigrated to South Africa. She never moved back to Italy. And it was a tremendous opportunity. She's 85 now, and it gets tender when you don't see them for a long time. So I hadn't seen her for about 18 months. And it was really good. I spent 5 days with her and then flew off to Johannesburg, where my other brother lives, caught up with him, and then ministered in 24/7 church, which is great. It's like our brother-sister church. We're related. I don't know if you're aware of that. It's the only church I know where they've got a file and they sing all our songs. Yeah. Amazing. It didn't even have to go via Bethel. It just went straight to 24/7. Amazing. Anyway, so they're a beautiful people. And we had the morning service with them. And then in the evening, they just gathered a lot of the churches in the area. And they're launching on the 5th of Feb, same day as we're celebrating. They're launching their first create kind of school. And they wanted to come under our banner. And so they have our artwork. And they've called priests, prophets, kings. They're launching the first prophetic school, which is awesome. Isn't it great? Very privileged. And so I don't know if you're all aware of what happens to the finance. It's not to, you know, give us a bonus. It goes, the finance that we got from the recent school actually went, if you look in the room next door, it paid for all the beam stripping, and it was the first kind of phase one, which was great. I think we were able to put about $4,000-$4,500 into the renovations just from the school, which is fantastic. So that's great. Again, we're continuing to, because they, you know, they asked me to give a testimony of what, why did you start the school? Why did you do that? And I began to speak to them about apostolic foundations, apostolic and prophetic. And I said, you can't have prophets on their own. You have to work with apostles. And you can't have apostles that don't change a community with their teaching. Teachers isolate people with just teachers if they don't mix with the apostles and prophets. Yes? They just gather to themselves according to their teaching. But what apostles and prophets do is they go deep into a foundation and they want to know what's going underneath the surface of people's lives and hearts, and they change communities. And so what we've managed to do from Create right at the outset was to start a project along with Bernard Inyonga and his wife Dorothy in Mbito, Kenya. And they were, now it would be so lovely. I want to get a whole lot of things hopefully by next week to show you what's happened, because they've built a place for 30 young boys, 30 young girls, and they're all orphans. They haven't got parents. They're raising them. They have medication for them. They, you know, because some of them are really have been ill. They haven't been looked after. They're fed. They're educated, and it's a tremendous community. And that's just, the church has basically adopted this whole work, and it's fantastic what's happening. And so I feel like apostolic ministry must change a community, must change lives somewhere. And I feel like, you know, when your dollar gets converted into Africa, it's like multiply. So we want to multiply the finance, come and invest and create when we open up again, and we're very excited about that. So yeah, we're very super excited. So that's what's going to happen in South Africa, is the proceeds is not, again, to do anything other than we want to be able to do projects from their base out and see what else we can get up to. Isn't that fun? This could really become a problem, which is what I hope will happen. Anyway, just to give testimonies, there were a lot of healings on Sunday night, and we prayed for a truckload of people. They stayed, you know, an hour and a half to 2 hours, just even just for a prayer, for a prophecy. And I love to do that, especially when you're only in one place for a short time. You just want to be able to give as much as you can, squeeze it, wring it all out, and leave. And so this morning when I came, I was really fresh. I just want to encourage you. In the area of words of knowledge, I gave three different words of knowledge that nobody put their hands up to. Absolutely nobody. It was like they all looked at me like the whole room was full, and they were all like, oh, this is a bad fear. This looks so bad. But I had a word about sans sushi and a business that was going to reopen. And then I wrote a hairdresser dash liver. And the third one was parents are missionaries, and God's going to reopen your hearts for the missions. Anyway, nobody responded. And then when a lady came up to me at the end and she said, look, I just want you to know, I was from Sans Sushi. My son is waiting for a liver transplant. He's married to a hairdresser. His business kind of folded. And so I think the word is for me. And I realized I'd strung all the things to try to make them all educated, like, instead of just gone dot, 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 does this make sense to anybody? So, you know, in our Western mindset, we try and look sort of, you know, professional. Point number one, point number two. I nearly missed the whole thing instead of just said it like he said it. So she was so encouraged. We got to pray for her son, and if we get a testimony that anything's changed in his body, we'll let you know. But that was super exciting. So don't ever be afraid of looking stupid, because I am the queen of all of that. And I don't mind going ahead of you and doing a fabulous job. So what else did I want to say? There was one other thing. No, just don't miss next week, like for anything. Okay, so don't go dying or anything on us, please, not next week. Put that off in your diary and just postpone any drastic events in your life. Right? Can you do that? Would you? Fantastic. Come attend if you can. You're going to get to hear the history of some of the stuff of what we walked through. Because, I mean, when, you know, George's on the drums there. He was only a five-year-old kid when we started out. And there were some fun stories. Not about him, don't worry. There's some fun stuff we're going to tell you about. But I want to encourage you, even tonight as we worshipped, that God is doing something that you don't always see. He's like an invisible sower. He does microsurgery on you. and you're not even aware of it. And some of you walk out of here so free and so less burdened because you're not always appreciating what's happening. And so I want you to hold the worship time sacred. Please know that that's why we don't kind of have a free-for-all and everyone brings their dinner in and does crazy stuff. We honor that time. It's like a really special and sweet time for us all. And I want to commend you for traveling like that in the Spirit. Not a whole lot of communities do that. But I want you to know 24/7, they do that. They track with that. They spend time and just allow God to come. And I really believe it has to do with being that innocent bride that is naked and unashamed. She's not afraid to be seen and she's not afraid to see him. Because a lot of fear and a lot of cynicism is purely you're terrified to find out that the love that you really wished for doesn't exist. That's really all it is. And in worship, you get to have a taste of that. And what faith grows by understanding that something is working in your body. And that's what makes you alive. That's why faith with works keeps you alive. And the working of that is the hand of God while you allow him to weave a thread in your life and put you together in a way that only he can. He's magnificent. And so I commend you. Well done for remaining. And so you're going to hear some of that journey next week, and we're going to have loads of fun. But here and now is my Prince Charming, Mr. Fintan Xavier de Jassini.
So, good evening. I thought I'd read something that Izzy posted on Facebook, because I'm not on Facebook, but I did get to read it because I look at her computer every now and then. And I'm not a wordsmith. I can write and I can read. But when some people write, it captures something. And I thought it'd make far more sense if I celebrate, because, you know, we're celebrating our 34th wedding anniversary with you all. I mean, just think about that. I said to Iz, what shall we do? It's our wedding anniversary. She said, let's go and just go to church and worship and be with the family of God. So that's pretty cool. I mean, I knew there'd be love songs and dancing, so you can't go wrong at Jubilee. Amen? But you're welcome. It's nice to be here with you. So I thought I'd read what she said If you are on Facebook, you may have read this already. So she wrote last night, 34 years together has meant millions of scenarios that span the extremes of life. Whether banal or extraordinary, a unique combination of discovery, bewilderment, wonder, joy, confusion, hilarity, spotlessness, chaos. I can't remember the spotlessness, but I'm sure it was there somewhere. Peace, ruffled hair, singing songs, wailing, losing keys, finding opportunities, raising our 6 champions and prodigies of hope. Whether full, come back, whether full of energy or in fetal position, with bouts of creativity amidst routine, embracing or fighting change, but always so relieved with each other's growing freedom, so many long days and so many sweet nights, so many beautiful memories, I would want to be with none other than you, my beloved Finn. Isn't that lovely? Thank you. So, I thought I'd share that because she puts it really well. So how are you going? Well, you can open to the book of Ephesians. We're going to be trundling through there. We're in Ephesians 4. And lots of celebration. And if you haven't got a Bible, we'll have it up on the screen for you. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. As I said this morning, to live a life worthy, Paul doesn't begin there. He starts in chapter 1 and chapter 2 and chapter 3, building us up from a platform of, you've been seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. You've been blessed with every spiritual blessing you're ever going to need. You are the beloved. You're loved. You've been saved by grace through faith. He's prepared good works for you in advance that you should walk in. He starts by 3 chapters of love, 3 chapters of hope, 3 chapters of building us up to where we realize that we didn't choose him, but he chose us. That if we believe in him and love him, if he gave us salvation, how much more will he not give us everything else with that? So it's he's the initiator, we're the responders. And then he says in chapter 4, now live a life worthy of your calling. I like that because so often we can, as Christians, think that, well, some people are called. I met someone, I had a calling from God. Has someone told you, I got a calling from God? Well, now you can say, well, yeah, me too. It's in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. And I'm living a life worthy. What does that look like? What does living a life worthy look like to you? I have no idea. But you work it out. Because it means that we're full-time Christians, 24-7. I'm sure that's why their name is 24-7. That we're not Sunday Christians. We're not part-time Christians. We're full-time. And so we want to live a life worthy because every day, every moment, every interaction, every shopping experience, every surfing experience, every time we go to work, we're representing Christ. We're ambassadors of his kingdom. And so Paul says, live a life worthy of that. Just live a life worthy. Not preach a life worthy. We haven't got to preach to make our lives count. We just got to be who God's called us to be. Be the most integrous, the most honest, the most loving, the most kind, the most humble. That's what it looks like. And he goes on to explain it. He says, be completely humble. Verse 2. What does completely humble look like? It means that you know exactly who you are without having to talk about it all the time. You see, a humble person just is. They love. They know who they are. Don't need to prove it. They can do whatever's required, whether it's clean toilets or whether it's eat at a 5-star restaurant. It doesn't matter. They are comfortable in any scenario because they know who they are. I love that. And it takes perfect humility to be that. It means that when you're invited to a banquet, Jesus said, choose the lower seat because you might get invited to be upgraded. Don't choose the best seat. Come on. And so humility is not thinking less of yourself. Humility isn't thinking of yourself at all. You see, because some people are like, I'm nothing, I'm nobody. No, you haven't actually found your identity in Christ yet, because you can never say we're nobody. We are somebody. We are, like, I don't want my kids to say, I don't know who I am, I'm just confused. I'm like, I'm a Jessini. I know who my dad is, I know who my mom is, I'm very secure, I'm happy, who I am. I want to raise confident kids, come on. I don't want them to be like, I don't know if I can do this, I'm useless. That's a terrible confession. That's false humility. That's like, I'm useless, I'm nobody, I'm a germ, I'm a worm, I'm living in the dust. That is not humility. Humility is like, I am a royalty. I'm a king's kid. And you'll find out if you spend time with me. I think like royalty. I live like royalty. And I can do anything. I can wash floors and I can drive a limousine. I'm comfortable in any realm. That's true humility. Knowing who you are, being confident, not boasting, not being puffed up, not conceited, not having to prove anything, just doing whatever it takes, anywhere, anytime. I love that. That's what true humility is. Amen. He says, and gentle, patient, bearing with one another in love. And I said, if you haven't had to bear with one another in love, stay a bit after the service. Just stay a bit longer tonight. Because you're going to meet people that are going to rub you up the wrong way. You're going to meet with people who are awkward, people who haven't been to church before, people who haven't learned Christianese. Or in fact, some people who have learned Christianese are the most annoying of the lot. Every sentence is a spiritual connotation. I'm like, no, I don't want to do that. No, God wasn't speaking to me. I just burped. Really, that was nothing. It wasn't spiritual. And the bearing with one another is that in that beautiful rainbow nation that God's made the church, they're people that God's deliberately put across our path who are going to teach us about patience. You cannot learn patience unless you have someone that requires you to learn that patience with. You can't learn patience on an island living by yourself. You could learn boredom, but you can't learn patience. Patience is only learned when that attribute is tested and pushed against. You want to learn patience? Get married, have 6 children. Just have one. It'll sort you out. Just have one. In fact, have one at a time. It's very advisable. Says me having had none. I just watched. and nearly passed out a few times. The whole of Ephesians is a love walk, and it takes us on a journey. As I said, Watchman Nee used three phrases. He wrote a book about this: sit, walk, stand. It's from the book of Ephesians, where we're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He says, then walk worthy of the Lord. And then in chapter 6, he speaks about having done all to stand and learning about spiritual warfare. We're going to get to that in a few weeks' time. But this journey, it's bearing with one another in love. Everything, the currency of heaven, the currency of church, the currency of the kingdom is love. That's why we have make no apology about spending an hour in worship where we get love from every angle. We give love, we receive love, there's a prophetic move of God, and every transaction with heaven is a transaction of love. And there's no shortage. You're never going to get a little sign saying insufficient funds. There's always enough love from heaven. Make every effort, verse 3, to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. I love the way that Paul assumes that we're in unity. Keep. Didn't say find it. Didn't say if you could just get together. No, actually, we're in unity. I'm in unity with the body of Christ. I'm in unity with the Catholics and the Hillsongers and the Baptists and the closed brethren and even the open brethren. I think there's two, but I'm in unity with them all. And the reason is, in verse 4, it says, because there's one body, one Spirit, one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all. It's not very difficult if there's only one God, one hope, one baptism. Then if I meet someone and they're from a different tribe or a different family of heaven, they're still my brothers and sisters. And therefore, I don't want to argue with them. I don't want to try and correct them. I don't want to try and tell them that Pentecostalism is better than cessationism and what on earth do they believe in the rapture for. I don't really care. One of them is going to be wrong and right about the rapture anyway. You know what I mean? Someone's going to be wrong. I'll be going, whoa, you were right. Woo! As I go up, you know? And no one's going to care. When you're in heaven, you're going to find that person and tell them, you were wrong, told you so. You'll be like, at the throne of grace. Come on. It's true. It's true. So when it says you have to make every effort, what that looks like is effort. Say effort. It takes effort to keep unity. And I don't know if you any were here last Sunday morning. There was a beautiful prophetic flow in the church. And Mark Hopper had an amazing word about 2017 being John 17, that in this year, we're going to experience incredible unity in the body of Christ. Just as Martin Luther kind of pegged those statements on the door 500 years ago. This year is the 500th anniversary of Martin Luther's declaration of faith and by grace through faith and not by works, and how he put those declarations on the door of the cathedral. Well, we need to put those declarations of unity and our declarations of hope on our bathroom door or wherever it is, so that we can say with faith that 2017, we're going to be the answer to Jesus' prayer in John 17, that they may be one, even as you and I are one, that the world may know. You see, because the world is not impressed when we are divided and we have camps and we criticize each other. The world doesn't, no one's impressed with that. I'm not impressed when journalists criticize politicians and just every day someone's getting trashed. And I hate it. I hate that aspect where whoever's in power is going to be pulled down a peg or two. There's never any celebration of, wow, this person's been, you know, in government for this long and look at the differences they've made. And there's like 13 pages of success. It just doesn't, they don't celebrate success. They're looking for fault all the time. And isn't it good that the body of Christ doesn't look for fault, but that we look for to celebrate every milestone, every success, every salvation, every victory, that we celebrate the victories. Because then we become a church that we're large-hearted. And that's why God will send to us people. And every week we have visitors from all sorts of denominations around Sydney and overseas and interstate. Why? Because they know that we don't hammer the church. We love the church. Because it's our church. It's our body. It's our bride. We're part of them. When they're doing well, we're doing well. When they're in pain, we're in pain. We gave a whole night of prayer, I think last year, in the middle of the year, there was some scandal about Hillsong and something, some criticism against their leadership, and we felt, that's our leadership. That's our church. We spent a whole night in prayer. They didn't know about it. We didn't say, hey, guys, we're going to pray for you guys. We just did it. They don't need to know. Heaven knows. We did it with our language. We did it with our life. We didn't do it with words. We did it with power. For a whole night, we gave a whole night of prayer for Hillsong. Why? Because we love Hillsong. Hillsong does well. We all do well. Come on. Verse 7 says, but to each one is of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. I don't know how clear this could get. To each one, that's like covers everybody. Past tense, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Now he's going to speak in the next, in two verses down, about the different grace gifts that's been apportioned. Well, you need to know that you've been given grace gifts. Those grace gifts are the gifts that when you do them, you feel grace. Now, we all got to do things that we don't like. I do that at home as a dad, as a husband, as a father. I'm doing things all the time, some things that I don't like. But the most of the things I do, I like doing them. They give me joy. They give me pleasure. My career gives me pleasure. My calling gives me pleasure. But even within that, I'm doing things that are not my gifting. Paul told Timothy to do the work of an evangelist. He wasn't an evangelist. But imagine spending your whole life doing the work of an evangelist when you're not an evangelist. That would be hard work. That would mean you'd be drained. A lot of the time you'd be building up yourself. I've got to do this stuff, man. I hate it, but I've got to do it. No, you've got to find your sweet spot and spend 80% of your energy and time doing the things you love. What is your calling? What is the grace gift on your life? You could look in 1 Corinthians 12. You can look in Romans 12. You can look in Ephesians 4. There's 36 different gifts in the Bible. 36. Probably more. Really, if you take psalmody and you add a few others. But there's specific gifts that God has given sovereignly. Some people are really good at administration. Really good at it. I'm not one of them. Really good. Some people are good with numbers. Some people are good at works of service. That's a gift. Being a deacon is a gift. Being unseen and being a deacon and just doing stuff and making things happen, that's a gift. Talking is a gift. I got that one and one or two others. But it's not everyone's gift. And you've got to find the grace that God's given you and say, I'm going to use that grace. I am going to function in my grace. Because you see, when the body functions, it matures, it grows. The body is built up when everybody operates in their gift. That's the joy. That's where the sweet spot is. Not with one person who's doing everything, running around like ragged and exhausted and expending too much energy because you have these professional, full-time people that are so gifted that everyone else looks a little bit silly. That is a tremendous failure. When a church creates people that aren't able to function in their gifts, it's a tremendously failing church. There you have it. I got to just put in verse 8 because it doesn't seem to fit in with 11 and 12, but I'm just going to say it because it's here. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he led captives in his train and he gave gifts to men. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. Now, it seems like verse 7 and 11 fit together, and this is like an interjection with Paul describing what happened at the cross. It's important that we know this, though, because he didn't just say it for no reason. He said it because at that time, and if you look in Luke 16, there's the parable about the rich man who had everything he needed, and there was this poor man at the gate, and he didn't get anything, and then he died and went to Abraham's bosom, and then the rich man died, and he said he saw Abraham in this waiting place, in this place of Hades or Sheol, where he wasn't in torment, but he wasn't in heaven. It was a waiting place, a different dimension, and he could see, and he could speak and communicate. And he said to Abraham, could you just send Lazarus to me to put a drop of water on my tongue because I'm burning up here. I'm being tormented. And obviously he couldn't. There was no exit from that place other than when Christ, in those 3 days, went down to the grave and preached to those who were in captivity. part of Isaiah 61 was that he went and preached captivity and led captives in their train. And every one of those saints of old who looked from a distance and didn't see what they'd been promised, they were waiting. Abraham waiting in comfort, but waiting for the full release, because the blood of bulls and goats cannot redeem you. Come on. And Christ went and preached to them, and that's why he could say to the thief on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. Come on. Because he was on his way, but he had to go down first. He had to go down, descend, and then come up. And so these are called the ascension gifts, because as he ascended, he gave gifts to men. He released onto the earth forever these gifts, which I'm going to talk about in the next verse, because he was going to equip the body of Christ to be a resurrection bride. This was going to be loosed across the whole earth. It wasn't going to be for exclusive few. It wasn't going to be for a religious class of people who dressed funny and spoke differently and spoke perpendicular, and they are the royal priests, and they come before God and they speak in this, holy. And I'm like, what is that? That's Old Testament. If I were to talk different to make you realize I'm a really holy person, what's the matter with me? I'm holy because of who I am. I'm just like you. I'm holy just like you are holy. We're all holy, for crying out loud. If you're unholy, you're not saved yet. And we're all priests. We're all priests. Every one of us is a priest. It wasn't that funny, but it was quite funny. And then it says this. He says, you see, before the church, there were priests, prophets, and judges, and kings. They ruled the people. There was the structure. In the New Testament, everyone's a king. Everyone's a priest. Everyone's royalty. That's the good news. So where do the fivefold gifts come in? Well, it says in the very next verse. I'm so glad you asked that question. It was he, God, who gave some, say some, to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers. That's the sweet spot. For some people, those five gifts, they have a gift from heaven. They open their mouth, and they're teaching. They open their mouth, and people get saved. Bang. They open their mouth, and foundations are laid, and signs and wonders follow, the gifts of the apostles. All those gifts are very clear. You look at the fruit of the tree, it's obvious what the tree is. You go there, that's an orange tree. It's got oranges on it. It's not a mystery. I don't know what my gift is, brother. I don't know what. What is the fruit coming out of your life? What's the sweet spot? What do you enjoy doing? Shouldn't be like, I've been waiting on God for 5 years. I don't know what my gift is. No. It's too long. You're overcomplicating it. Read those three chapters. Read those three passages. 1 Corinthians 12. You can have several. You can have clusters of gifts. You hear what I'm saying? You can have several gifts at the same time. Isn't that amazing? Why did he give those gifts to the church? It says to prepare God's people for works of service. But surely, Finn, the professional, full-time people should do the works of service. No, that's failure. If your pastors are exhausted because they've been doing the works of service, they're not doing the job properly. They haven't read the Bible. They are worn out, and it's not godly. A successful, thriving, healthy local church is where the people are equipped to do the works of service. And they know, I am good at this service. And I was saying this morning that there are many people in our church that we've equipped who have exceeded us in their gift mix. They're doing a better job than we are at the very thing that we equip them to do. That is success. Come on. I could mention names, but I'm going to leave someone out, and it's going to be unhelpful. You know who you are. So to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. The whole goal is to build up the body of Christ. Aren't you happy when the body of Christ gets built up? Because you hear people lining up to give testimonies, and people are ministering here, and people are doing kids ministry, and people are doing evangelism, and people are doing worship, and people are traveling here and going there. And why? Because it's the body of Christ is being built up. No one's feeling like, I'm useless, I can't do anything. No, everyone can do something. And they realize, I can do this. I'm serving. I am building up the body of Christ. That's why it's so important not to be a passenger, not to be a spectator. Because a spectator hasn't learned who they are and what they can be released to do. If you learn what you're released to do, then you can do it. If it's emailing, if it's writing poetry for people, if it's the gift of encouragement is a gift. What do you do? I encourage people every day. That's important. You phone five people every day because you've got the gift of encouragement.
Barnabas was an encourager. That was one of his gifts. In his mix, he was like, well, yeah, but what's your ministry? I encourage people. I already told you, I encourage people every day. I send them texts. I tweet. I post posts on Facebook. I was going to say Facegram, but that doesn't exist. Facegram. I'm a Facegrammer. I have a face. And a book. And a gram. But what is wrong with that? But I didn't see you. I didn't read your post. I didn't know you. Well, you see, I'm encouraging people. I know that I'm encouraging them. And I'm doing this for God, before God. I'm not actually doing it for you to see it. And so if you're ignorant of what I'm doing, that's your bad. It's too bad. But don't judge me, because I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm called to do. And I'm doing it every single day. I'm not just part-time. I'm full-time. And I'm making a difference. Because that's you being secure in your calling. Remember? First one, you got a calling. Know what your calling is, and then live out your calling every single day. It's not part-time. It's every day. And if people don't see it because you're not a musician or you... What percentage of the church actually gets seen doing their stuff? Very few. 10%. What do the rest of us do? Well, we're doing stuff every day. Some of it's our career that we're called. Some of it's our parenting. That's pretty good calling. Come on. Raising the next generation. But all of it is for God, under God, and all of it matters to God, and it matters to you. And you must be secure that you are fulfilling God's calling for your life, whether people know it or not. Wow. So if no one sees it, and no one's recognized it, and no one's given you a title yet, it's okay. As long as you know it. Yeah. Amen. I love building up the church. I love traveling. I love encouraging pastors. I love encouraging leaders, because I want people to get happier than me. Took me a long time to get happy, and I don't want them to wait 10 years to find their joy. So verse 13 says, it's talking about building up the body until we all reach unity in the faith and in this knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. I love that. This is a journey, man. This is a big, big passage here. Until we all reach the unity in the faith. You see, unity in the Spirit, first part, is like, that's easy. We're one in the Spirit. Yeah, Baptist, awesome. Woo! Anglicans, yeah, I love the Catholics. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Then they start praying. I'm like, oh, that's a terrible prayer. That's embalmed in unbelief. How can you pray that prayer? Oh, you don't say that loud. You just think in your head. You see, because that's the trickiness comes when you're trying to live together and dwell together in unity and actually work out the stuff, because you're like, oh, yes, you know, God just gave me this cancer to teach me something. I'm like, that's crap. That's not true. How could God give you the flu? You might have got the Hong Kong flu, but there's no heavenly flu, you know? It's like, and people have they're holding on. Yes, I'm learning. I've learned so much through this terrible malady I've been struck with by God. I'm like, oh, my God. I want to ask them, and are you happy? And I'm like, how's it working out for you? So I suspect. But these are things you think, you don't say that out loud, you just think it. Because that's, you see, we want to reach unity in the faith, and that's a more tricky thing, because it's unity of what we believe. It's unity of the faith. It's a longer process than unity of the Spirit. In the Spirit, I'm one with you. I don't want to know what you believe. I don't really care what you believe. It's like we want, hey, we're brothers. Yay, you're Baptist. Woo. And you go baptize and do stuff. I'm a Pentecostal. Unity of the faith, though, is going to happen. And it's until we attain to the full measure, the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So we're on our way there. And I believe that God is linking churches, linking people, causing the barriers and denominational structures to come down. I told you about that amazing experience I had in Papua New Guinea in December, where we had, I think, 40 denominations together for 5 days. 40. There were every tribe, every kind of, there were denominations I hadn't heard of before that were there. They were there. And they used to, for years and years, they had their little barriers and their little ways of doing things, and quite small churches spread out across this nation. And in their history, they'd never had a meeting like that for 5 days. Come on. And I was a speaker and they hadn't heard of me before they came. So it wasn't me that drew them. It was the Holy Spirit doing a work in Papua New Guinea in the hearts of leaders. And we become mature. I like the thing about maturity because maturity is our goal. We want people to mature. When you meet immature people, immature Christians are very easily offended. You just stepped on my very precious belief. You just, woo, how could you say that? I've believed that for years, and you just dismissed it as though it's unimportant. Well, that's immaturity. You can hear someone say something, and you're like, really? That's so nice. Lovely. Oh, that's lovely. See, because maturity means that you can mix with people and be with people from every different walk of life. You've nothing to prove. I was part of a denomination, and the regular phrase coming out of the leader's mouth was, most Christians don't do da-da-da-da-da. And the implication was, what we're doing is amazing. And I used to get more and more hurt by that statement because I'm like, I've got a local church, 400, maybe 500 people. I don't know what everyone of them believe. How would you know? And they're in my church. I meet with them every week. I don't know everything about them. How would you know what most Christians believe when there's 2 billion of them? You haven't a clue. You're a pea brain. Stop it. I used to get so cross. Most Christians, as though we dismiss the body of Christ. There are millions of Christians doing amazing work for God. Millions of churches, millions of leaders laying down their life, working in the Middle East, in persecuted countries. We have no nothing. We're not worthy to untie their laces. They are so amazing men of God, women of God, paying a tremendous price. How dare we criticize them? Like as though we have some understanding of the body of Christ. We haven't a clue. I hardly know what all my family believe. You know what I mean? How would I know what the body of Christ believes? It's none of my business. I don't make general statements. And then you'd get this statement of like, when did you last tarry 1 hour with God? I'm like, man, it's so long, I can't remember. It's like when I used to remember when my last confession was when I was a Catholic. Man, I don't know. It was like years, I think, since my last confession. You feel bad. You see, I can easily make you feel bad and use scripture to make you feel bad. But you see, Jesus said to Peter, feed my sheep. He didn't say beat my sheep. Feeding and beating is a whole different transaction. We know the difference. We feel the difference. I can motivate you to give by making you feel bad. And all of you start feeling bad and like, yeah, there's poor people and you haven't given enough. And how can you just have that third coffee when people can't even eat? And I can just put that big, heavy thing on you and you'll feel bad and you'll respond out of that. That's not God's motivation. He doesn't use that to lead us. Not his heart. We've got to feed the sheep, not beat the sheep. I'm preaching myself happy. You're doing great. I'm verse 14. Then we'll no longer be infants. I like that because infants have a me. They're selfish. Infants are like me, 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 me. It's my food. That's my bicycle. That's mine. And as you mature, you think, what's mine is yours. You need my car. You need some money. Can I pay for your groceries? You see, because generosity will always overcome greed. Generosity will always trump any selfishness, and immaturity is always going to be beaten and trumped by extreme love and extreme generosity. Even if you give to where you think, oh, I think I've overgiven now, you can never outgive God because it deals with infancy. And the thing about infancy is important because over the years, and it gives us why, it says, no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So let me come back to the waves blown here and there. Now, you know, when you've been a Christian for over 40 years, I've seen every wave and wind of doctrine. And some things I like embraced, wow, we've got to do this. This is amazing. Oh, ta-da, we're off on a horse. We're going to take this. And then everyone, the whole church is like, woo, let's go that way. And then like, no, that's not so good anymore. Let's go that way. And then you realize, actually, let's just go the middle way. Let's just stay steady. And there are going to be extremes. There's going to be ebbs and flows of doctrines. And you know, we had guys come through Sydney, and they got this extreme view on a specific subject. And people would come to me and say, Finney, shall we go? He's coming. He's coming again to Sydney. He's going to have a party in this area. I'm like, go. So, oh, Finney, shouldn't you prevent the church from going to these extreme things? No, because that's how we keep people infants. I want my children to learn through discernment. At a certain age, I'll say, no, don't do that. When they're under 10 and 11 and they're still learning, I'm going to say, no. I'll teach you what to do. But when they get to teenagers, I want them to work out where they should mix with, who they should go with, because I'm teaching them adult skills so they can learn to befriend the right people. They can learn to make wise decisions and wise choices. Otherwise, I'm going to keep them infants. If I have to keep making the decisions for them, I'm not helping the church to say to them, you shouldn't watch this, don't go there. So I said, go. When they came back, I said, how was it? And many of them said, it was weird. And you see, then I didn't have to tell them, look, I think if you go there, it's going to be weird. And you might have a false spirit there. Why? Why put fear? Because I think you go to a place, if there is a weird spirit, you can just say, that was a weird spirit. I didn't open my heart to it. I'm not worshiping weird spirits, but I just think that was weird, and I can see the fruit is not good, and I'm going to avoid that ministry in the future. That's maturity. I want to raise mature saints. And when you're Googling and listening to some podcast, and that podcast makes you feel condemned, and makes you feel like you're never good enough, and it makes you feel pressured to give, don't give. Put on your discernment and think, no, I'm not going to give. I'm going to be free. I'm not going to give. Ha, 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 ha. And they say, you must tithe to us. No, tithe to local church. Don't tithe to ministries that you have no responsibility for you and won't. You can't call them in the middle of the night and they won't be there for you when you're weeping and wailing and needing to get married and buried and do stuff. They won't be there for you. Come on. Use discernment. Get mature. Gosh. Stuff comes out. Stuff comes out. And it says that the maturity comes when the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Say, as each part does its work. What's your part? What's your part? Because each part must do its work. Remember I said in chapter 2, it says that God prepared in advance good works that he prepared for us to do. Now, good works are fun works. They're the fun things that we get to do. But they all work. It feels like work. Don't tell me that after I've preached and had a 10, 12, 14-hour day at ministry, I'm not tired. I'm exhausted, but oh, I am so happy. I'm like, oh, my goodness, Lord, you moved. People got touched. People, you showed up, and that person got touched. I saw them getting touched, and oh, that person came. They haven't been in church for months and months, and they came back, and I'm so grateful. But am I exhausted? Of course I'm exhausted. If God uses you, you're going to feel used. It's impossible not to. And so when every ligament, every part of the body does its part, that's when the body gets built up. That's when it works. If you see one area of the church struggling and people exhausted and oh, isn't there enough volunteers, it's something's not working. It's like we should have an abundance. We should have people queuing up and saying, I'll make coffee. I'll do the kids. I'll do sound. I'll do the things that no one can see. I'll do this. I'll do that, because we got hundreds of people in the church. You hear what I'm saying? The church is built up when every part does its work. Every part. So whatever, you haven't found it yet, look for it. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I'll come down to land. How are you doing? Great. Me too. Thank you. Thank you for asking. So, verse 17 says, so I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord. I don't know what that means. that if I tell you something and insist, that takes another level. So he's insisting, yeah. He changes his tone. That you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. I like the juxtaposition that Paul does with sensitivity and sensuality, because they're two distinct things. I believe that every one of us needs to have super sensitive, soft hearts towards God so we can weep. Izzy has a line that in one of her songs she sang this morning about strong men cry, or something like that. So how strong men cry. I mean, it's a very powerful phrase, because to cry is not a weakness. To cry is a strength, because it shows a soft heart. It shows a tenderness. So in the Lord, we're becoming more and more sensitive and more soft in our hearts to spiritual things, to spiritual truth, to not grieving God's Spirit, to walking with the Spirit. That's something that we mature and we become softer in God, actually. The more God touches you, the softer you become, not the harder. That's why I try and deal with hurts and disappointments very quickly, because if you have a hurt or disappointment, you build up a wall and you harden your heart. Amen? Because you are, that person hurt me, that leader hurt me, I'm not going to go there again. And so you stand like a totem pole in the worship, lest God get too close to you and soften your heart and make you start crying like Finney, which would be awkward. So there's sensitivity and then there's sensuality. And so the world is indulging, because that's an indulgent thing. It's about me, it's about my erotic fantasies, it's about my life, it's about fulfilling what I feel. Well, that's the world. He's comparing a very good description, is that we want to give ourselves to the Holy Spirit. And he's a Holy Spirit. And so all that sensitivity will bring itself forward in beautiful experiences with God, intimacy with God, encounters with God, encounters in the glory, with no reference to sensuality. Amen? That's what I think he's saying. That's what I think. You, however, did not come to know Christ that way. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. So, Paul is the greatest writer in the New Testament. And if you look in Romans 5 and 6 and 7, he speaks about how the old nature was dead. Our old man was dead. You look at, I think his dead comes up 16 times. Dead, 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 dead. So the old man is dead. You get born again, you get a new creation. You've lost your sin nature. That your nature is no longer to sin. You can sin. But it's not your nature to sin, because your old nature has been buried dead with Christ. When Christ died, Paul says, I died. So if your old nature is dead, it's dead. Don't visit it. Don't bring flowers and go and talk at the gravestone, all right? So I miss you. Hey, no, because sin is fun. People don't sin for no reason. They sin because it's fun. You know, I just love the fact, somebody was speaking this morning, we were in worship, and we were talking about a train, the glory train or something train. What was the train? The peace train. There we go. It was the peace train. It was Cat Stevens. The peace train. And that came up somehow. I don't know how, but you know, in Jubilee, anything can happen. There's something can come in. And it reminded me of a meeting I was in at Melbourne, and it was a hectic glory outpouring. And we were like, these rows here, there were two, 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 and two, and we formed a glory train. So we were on the glory train. I was the driver, the train driver, because we were drunk out of our minds. We were completely off our faces. We were screaming, boop, and we're like, people are falling off the train, getting back on the train. Other people were coming across the room to get in the train. And this went on for a good half an hour, the whole glory train experience. And you see, we had no alcohol, didn't need it, had no after effects. It was for free. And we got smashed. I mean, we got seriously intoxicated that night. And it was a very memorable experience. And, you know, on Australia Day, everyone's saying, don't drink and drive. Don't drink and swim. Because expecting us all to get on the bottle on the Australia Day, just drink, drink, drink. You see, because that's the nature of sin is that let's get blotto. The more, and I see people with cases of beer, walking around, cases of beer. I'm like, three people in a case of beer. I'm like, whoa, that should be fun. Hey, they don't know any other fun. They don't know that in the glory we can get completely smashed and get drunk as skunks and get overwhelmed and hold on to the poles and can't drive our cars, because that's the original. Everything else is a counterfeit. Cases of VB, that's the counterfeit. Come on, we need a case of the glory. You need a case of heaven. You need to get in the glory train. The glory train, the peace train. So I love that. But so Paul is very clear in Romans 5, 6, and 7 that our nature, the old nature is dead. We have a new nature, old nature, things have passed away. But then he says this, and I love it because he's the same guy. He just says, put off your old self. So there is a truth that the old man's dead. He's died, he's buried, he's gone, and then he came back. It's like, oh, I put you off. Go away. Oh. And you find yourself reacting, saying things, doing things, thinking things that are part of your old self. Don't be like, I'm schizophrenic. I'm born again. How do I have these weird thoughts? No. Weird thoughts come. That's how Paul says, put it off. Same as he says, take every thought captive. You got to put it off. Just put off that sin. Don't do it. Put it off. Take it off. To be made new, verse 23, to be made new in the attitude of your minds. I like that. And to put on a new self. So there's an old self you can take off and a new self you can put on. Even though your old self is dead, he says take it off. And he reminds us, don't do that. So he's a father, knowing that some old habits die hard. Some mindsets take a while to change. I've said this many, many times to you, Jubilee, be patient with yourself. Because if you're patient with yourself, you'll be patient with others as well. It's true. Grumpy people don't like themselves. That's why they're grumpy. If they liked themselves, they'd be happy. And they'd like you more. They put up with your stuff because they can't put up with their own stuff, and so they're grumpy with everybody because they're miserable themselves. So put off your old self and put your happy self on. Created to be like God, verse 24, in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off, he gives some clarification on what that looks like, falsehood, speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we're all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. I love that. In your anger, do not sin. Didn't say, don't get angry. If you're angry, it's wrong. No, Jesus was angry. He got angry at the temple, made a whip, kicked over the tables. There was righteous anger. When we see injustice, when we see stuff going on in the world that people are getting hurt and abused, we must be angry about that. It must galvanize us to acts of justice and acts of prayer and going overseas and doing stuff and making decisions, because that anger is good. We don't take it out on people. We don't sin in our anger. That's the thing. It's that in your anger, don't sin. Didn't say don't be angry. Because when we're angry and we speak, sometimes we say things that are very cutting. I've done it far too often. And then I think, oh man, how do I get those words back? It was, oh, shouldn't have said that. Then you've got to apologize. And I'm so sorry, I didn't mean that. Came out. Well, because in my anger, I spoke. In my anger, I did something. Please don't. You haven't got the microphone. I'll speak to you afterwards. I'd love to. Not now. Thank you so much. Just be seated. Don't go anywhere. We're almost done. Then he says this beautiful phrase. He says, do not let the sun go down while you're angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. Here's the thing. Don't let the sun go down before you've resolved relational conflicts. Obviously, in my case, it's normally marriage and children. Nothing worse than like, an argument, and you go, I'm going to sulk, and you try and sleep, and you can't sleep because you're angry. And the Holy Spirit won't let you sleep.
because you've got to make up. Because you don't want to start the next day still with today's drama, today's unresolved issues. It's a very good word, very important word. And it's not just for marriage, it's for friendships, it's for things. And you sent that text and it was like a cutting text, and like, and you, it's 10 o'clock at night, you're going to go to bed and like, I should make up. That's the Holy Spirit. Make up. Send a gentle text with a happy face and a sorry so you can go and sleep properly. Amen. In your anger, don't sin. It's good. Sun, go down. I'm coming down to land. I'm trying to finish this chapter. How are you doing? Oh, just read the rest. It's all good. Father, you've been so good to us. We've received chapters of love, chapters of affirmation, every blessing in heavenly places. And we thank you for our place that we have in Christ, and even in Sydney in these days. We're living in the goodness of God, and we're living in the grace of God, and we're living in tremendous revelation and seeing and hearing your testimonies every week of your signs and wonders. We're living in a tremendous time in history, and we're so grateful. And I pray that everybody in this place, Lord, today, tonight, might be certain of their calling, might know the grace that's on their life, some of the gift mix that God's given them. And if they haven't yet started to build up the body, that they can start to function in those gifts and feel so connected to the body and build up the body as we need every single person. And so I bless everyone with an amazing week this week, that you might let your face shine on us and give us peace in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Thank you, guys. If anyone has a word of knowledge on the team,